This video is aimed at students. It's about how to acquire the fundamental knowledge for being able to understand ecology and conservation. It's about how to do better at exams. And it's what are the 8 tips that I think might make it easier to get a job in ecology and conservation. So this is linked to a playlist on my YouTube channel, which has 28 videos that I think have the fundamental concepts that are useful for understanding ecology and conservation. And inserting those into exam scripts, I'm sure, will be appreciated by examiners. So for example, if you're thinking about biological diversity, you really want to understand the differences between alpha, beta, and gamma diversity. If you're thinking about the spread of species, perhaps invasive species or responses to climate change, you want to understand leptokurtic dispersal, as that explains where all the action is. If you're interested in food chains or food webs, then you need to understand the implications of the laws of thermodynamics. So I hope those concepts are useful. So what are the 8 ideas for making you more employable? Firstly, is to improve your knowledge of natural history. And that's made easier nowadays by the fact there are all these apps. So for example, a good start is to learn about birds. And there's Merlin, which is a free app. And it'll say, for this site here, what are the birds that you're most likely to see? And it'll tell you what they are, and wood pigeon, robin, climbing crow. These are all birds that I've seen this morning. And then there's an identify option for birdsong. And it's picked up the chiff-chaffs that have just arrived. Calling chiff-chaff, chiff-chaff. Birds have just arrived from Africa. And then there's iNaturalist as well. So I've taken a photo of the leaves of this shrub and put that in iNaturalist. And it's told me that it's elder, Sambuca nigra. So that there's a range of apps that makes identification much easier. And natural history underpins a lot of conservation. I should stress that these getting better, but they're not 100% accurate, and their accuracy varies around the world. So they provide a good starting point, but if you want to take the identification seriously, then check with other sources. And there's a lot of stuff online, and you can then see how confident you are. My second suggestion is think about the skills that it'd be useful to have as a conservation practitioner. So think about, is it useful to have some practical skills, some analytical skills, have a driving license, all sorts of things. What would be beneficial? And a good way of thinking about this is to look at the job descriptions of the sort of job that you could ideally have, and then look at the skills that they ask for and ask yourself, do you have those skills? Or could you acquire those skills? The third thing is just join in. At wherever you're doing your degree, there are probably seminars and workshops and talks and events. Just be part of it. Meet people, talk to people, learn that extra information. And you can also do this by joining external bodies. So here I'm at the River Lark, and the River Lark Conservation Partnership in England has training sessions, it has work parties. It's a great way of learning a set of extra skills. And most nature reserves, many conservation organizations, will have opportunities for volunteers to come along, have an enjoyable time doing some practical conservation and learning some skills, or helping in other ways, helping monitor, all sorts of things. Next one is ensure that you're up to date in your knowledge. So if you're interested, say, in bees or butterflies or policy or social science, just think about the literature, the policy changes that are happening. So make sure that when there's a discussion going on, you know what's going on. You're up to date with thinking. The fifth idea is publishing. So it's much appreciated when applying for jobs if you can point to things that you've published. And it's unlikely you're going to produce a major paper, but think about whether or not your project could be published. But think about if there are observations or material or other things that you could write about. And increasingly now the world is about social media. So think about having a social media presence. And if you can show that you can do that, then employers will be find that a great skill. If I can do YouTube, you can do videos. I'm sure you can do them much better. And a key thing to think about is if you're going to show this to others for professional reasons, then make sure you've separated your personal social media from your professional social media. Sixth thing is just link up. Try to find other people with similar interests that you can share knowledge, you can talk to them, you can learn. That's a very enjoyable and a great way of building up your skills. Seventh thing is to just think. When you're going out, seeing why are people doing what they're doing? What's the reason for that? Why is the world as it is? Why is this site like it is? Why is this river like it is? Why is this conservation practice being carried out? Why is this policy being developed? By thinking and exploring, you're going to be a much more deep and knowledgeable and thoughtful ecologist and conservationist. And then finally, just enjoy life. Just enjoy being a conservationist, thinking about science, thinking about policy and practice. It's a fascinating world. It's great being a conservationist, great being an ecologist. So I hope you can really enjoy that as well. So I know that getting a job can be really difficult and challenging. And I wish you luck. I wish you luck in building up your skills. I wish you luck in your degree. And I wish you luck in your career, whatever you decide to do. Good luck.